Janice has had an extensive career in the NHS, and she's and like all people who've got superb careers, and who, and this is for the students by the way, who have done well in nursing, they don't just stay in one narrow area. Janice is a good example of somebody who's moved around and tried different experience, different areas, worked in different parts of the health area, particularly within nursing. She began as an A&E nurse, and I'm sure we'll hear more about some of the things she's done. But she's worked in a range of clinical areas and then moved into management. She's been the trust executive as a director of nursing previously, but is currently, as I've mentioned, in the largest trust in this country and across Europe as director of nursing. She had a spell of 6 years with working with the Chief Nursing Officer of England, and in that period she was given some really tough assignments, I think it's fair to say. One of them was to reduce MRSA, and she did, and that was a great success, and reduced it by 80%. Then C. difficile was reduced, another big challenge that everybody's aware of, and reduced it by 60%. And also implemented what was a big controversial issue at the beginning of this decade, which was about multi-sex wards. So we had men and women in the same accommodation, which everybody felt was totally unsatisfactory, but had been implemented in previous years. So changing all of those cultures has been some of her achievements, but only some of the achievements that Janice has been able to lead on. And I think one of the things that's really a mark of her tremendous success is it's been very much about changing culture, which we all know is the most difficult thing in the world to do. It's not enough to just flick a switch with people, you have to get people to believe and work with you, and I think she's done some fantastic work in that area. So I've already given you the sort of where Janice is now, and I'm really looking forward to hearing Janice Stevens, who was awarded the CBE in 2010 and was named in 2014 by the Nursing Times as one of the most influential nursing leaders. We're very proud to have you here, Janice, and please welcome.
Hello everyone, it's really lovely to be here. I was thinking about my journey on the way here and thinking about how did I end up here. I started off from humble beginnings as a really important A&E nurse. But you know, you kind of think, how am I ending up standing here and what's gone on to kind of get me into that place? And I think I just want to start by saying, firstly, thank you for the privilege of being here. You've played a part in my development and support around education. But I think also there's two people I want to pay tribute to that I think have helped me on this journey. And the first would be the person that taught me the values and the behaviours and the unconditional love and the support and the belief that you can do anything that you want. And that's my mum, and it would have been her birthday this weekend. So I'm kind of thinking of her at this time, thinking about, she's quite chuffed that I'm standing here today. And the second is the support of my husband, who actually, you know, he's incredibly tolerant. Tolerant and supportive, and just, you know, when I'm going to tell you about the Barts experience, just kind of went, just go for it if you want to do it. And that just kind of takes a lot of weight. So they're really important influences and support in my life, and I think, you know, have helped me be the person that I am here. I'm going to share a story with you, I'll share my journey with you. And try to refer to the literature on some of the things that I've picked up. I was in a car with Tony actually, talking about thinking it was time for a new challenge and what was I going to do next. And I kid you not, this is true. Tony was saying, well, you never did get the London experience, did you? We're in the car. And I'm like, well, you never know. 2 hours later, I got a phone call. No kidding you. Just a certain with from the TDA saying, we'd like you to go, and what did they describe it as? Steady the ship. So literally 2 weeks later, I was at Barts Health. And it has been the most incredible 8 months so far. of my career, really, for lots of different reasons. And I thought I'd share the experience because I think I'm going to tell you stuff that I think you could find in most organisations. So I don't think, even though we're in special measures and not in a great place, that actually if you walk some of the wards, you would see some of the things or hear about some of the things that I'm telling you about tonight. So I don't think we're unique. The fact we're in special measures doesn't mean that, you know, it means we've got a lot to do. But I often think, in my career, I've worked with a lot of trusts, and you sometimes think when you go in, even though you see fantastic things, you do think they're for the grace of God. And I know any nurse director that, or senior nurse leader that's sitting here would have that same view. So what can I tell you about my experience? So I'm going to kind of just give you a little bit of background, because I think just understanding the scale of BART is worth understanding. The challenges that I faced, and just some of my observations, then I'll link it to the literature, and then I'll tell you about what I've done and just my observations of these 8 months. Does that seem like a reasonable thing to do? Cool. So it is the biggest trust in Europe, actually, but it's enormous. But it's not just lots of sites, there are a lot of sites, but there is, you know, you've got a great big London teaching hospital, whacking big blue PFI in the middle of Whitechapel that looks like somebody's dropped a spaceship into the East End. You've got the oldest hospital in the country, St Bartholomew's, which is stunning, stunning combination of old and new that's now turned into one of the world leading heart attack hospitals. So you've got two big places like that, and then you've got a range of districts. So you've got Whipps Cross, which has always had its challenges as a district general hospital. Newham, which is a smaller trust that's kind of, you know, that's got some really good stuff, but it's kind of sat on the periphery. And then Mile End and some community services. I was there 6 weeks when I got an invitation to go to the dental hospital opening. It was at that point I went, I have a dental hospital? So I went to visit the dental hospital clinic. So it is enormous, and this is the size of one of the challenges about how you make change at this level of scale. Over 1,000 beds, 15,000 staff, got 70,000 nurses. The one at the bottom is the one that's really stark, 1,000 nurse vacancies at the moment. Just nurses say, just take a deep breath. I do it all the time. Those are the sort of numbers, nearly half a million emergency admissions. So it's huge. And I think that's part of, some people have asked me, is it too big? I don't think it's too big, I just think you've got to be really, really organised. And part of our challenge was it wasn't very organised. So CQC went to Whipps Cross, found some not great care, but some good stuff. Interesting, of all the reds, the things that featured most strongly was the caring. So actually the greens featured in caring in all the domains across all the hospitals, and most of them. So that kind of gave me hope, that actually, although there was a lot to put right, fundamentally, both patients were saying that they got care, good care. But everything else around it has been hugely, hugely disorganised. We're failing, we're not doing well on money. So hold your breath. 135 million predicted overspend this year, which we're struggling with at the moment. But we will come in on target. One of the things I think is really interesting, of the overspend, last year we paid 55 million in fines because we weren't hitting some of the targets. So actually, and that didn't come back, so you're like failing, so they take money off you, so you get worse. So I think that's one of the real, little P political challenges that we face, that we've already, even this year, even though they know we're busting a gut to try and turn some of this around, because we're still not doing well on four hour in A&E, we've already been fined. So it's strange. I've never been to an organisation with such poor IT. Consider it's a great big London teaching hospital. My computer takes 15 minutes to warm up, and I jest not. So imagine if you're trying to do that in a clinic, or in, you know, you're a doctor trying to write how a nurse wanted to get on. It's really, really poor. And I think as an organisation, what they did was, when they were trying to save money, they do all the things like strip out the stuff that actually you think you can take out, but it's such a false economy, like communications and IT, and, you know, estate stuff. So it's really almost like at every level we were not doing well. So that's why we got rated inadequate and got put into special measures. It's also just it's really interesting to see what else is unique or particularly interesting about Bart's Health. We have a hugely diverse population. In Newham alone, there's 112 different languages spoken. And in Tower Hamlets, which is where the Whitechapel bit is, about 80 different languages. So I have in my establishment 95 people employed around advocacy and language support. So it's the cultural world is really fascinating. But actually, we have got a represented population of the workforce. 49% of the staff are from BME populations around the area, and a lot of people are local. So that's good, but it brings interesting challenges and dynamics that I think we should become exemplar at working with and embracing. And so although we've got some good work, I think we could do an awful lot more. There'd been 2 years ago a workforce review, and here's a lesson I think about best intentions. When the trust merged, there was inequity in banding staffing numbers. Although there were still a lot of vacancies, and there was a decision taken to streamline everything across, try and make it all the same. So people were down banded. Lots of things happened that made people hugely, hugely angry. And even when I came in March, there was still terrible, terrible anger and a sense of letdown. And lots and lots of experienced nurses left, which, by the way, we're now paying on expensive agencies. So, you know, there's something about unintended consequences. You kind of get, well, why should you get an 8B here and an 8A there? But there's something about how do you do that in a way that is responsive and respectful of your staff and your workforce. But it caused a lot of problems. And so when I came in, the staffing levels were really, really not good in all the areas. Staff definitely felt disempowered. Some still do, because you're trying to reach so many people. They felt they had no decision making, that they were being done to, not done with. The culture is very different in all the trusts. And one thing I've learned, for anybody that's managing a multi-site or working in a multi-site trust, I don't think you have to try and create the same culture everywhere. I think you have to embrace the difference between and the uniqueness of each organisation. What you have to do is have a common set of values about how you behave, how you treat staff, how you look after patients. But actually, Newham is never going to be the same as St Bartholomew's. It doesn't matter what you do. It's, you know, you've got the oldest hospital in its pride, first RGN at St Bartholomew's. It's never going to feel the same as Newham, but you know, you go to Newham and it feels like a family. You go down the corridor and everybody knows everybody. So there's something about trying to make that similarity. Just, you don't have to do it. The common currency should be, we're all going to deliver high quality patient care, and we're going to look after our staff and live by those values. What happened in the merger as well, which was interesting, was that there was a recognition that this was an opportunity to deliver really great care to the population of East London, which has got a huge, you know, level of deprivation. It's got the highest growing birth rate in the country. A lot of issues. But actually, there was a feeling that if you could get some of the care to work across all the across the site, so pathways that work wherever care is being delivered, that was going to be better for patients. Because clearly in the merger, you know, midwifery care at Newell might be different from midwifery. So you wanted to get some consistency, and again, the currency was about high standards, evidence-based practice, and compassionate care delivery of that. So what the trust did was set up what they called CAGs. It just loves NHS jargon. I'm going to try not to use too much of it. Clinical academic groups. I call them divisions or directorates, and they did that across the trust. But what they didn't do was, and then they said, "You are now CAGs. Go and be CAGs and run the hospital." it was almost Jean-Luc Picard-esque. Make it so. And so they went off and all did their own thing. And that's really interesting, because what they were trying to do was set up matrix working, but didn't really look at the literature of what is required to work in a matrix. And what you know about what the literature says about matrix working, firstly, for those that, you know, just to kind of state what that is, that's really about saying when you've got horizontal normal hierarchies, actually what you try to do in vertical hierarchies, what you try to do is lead across. And often that means that you can also have two lines of accountability. But what the literature also says is that to make a successful matrix work, it really only works in really mature organisations. So big corporations outside the NHS, you know, the ones, the globals, will work in a matrix, but they'll have been around for a long time and they'll have worked at it. So when you're setting up a matrix organisation, you kind of have to over-engineer right at the start. And you have to actually be, it's counterintuitive. You actually have to put really robust governance in at the start and be really, really clear about accountability and responsibility. And if you look at what makes it work, the top bits, what Barts did in Make It So was unclear accountability. It created bureaucracy. There was high levels of uncertainty. So all those things that actually, what they say about, you know, prevent the negatives, actually were living and breathing and were a really, really big part of the problem. And, you know, I'll make it really practical. One of my directors of nursing for elderly care and emergency department was working across three sites and had responsibility for 39 wards and three emergency departments. How can you lead that when actually it takes 45 minutes to get from the London to Whipps Cross? So the whole way that it was being organised was really kind of not fit to deliver such a complex organisation that wasn't really mature. It had only been merged for 2 years. So what happened then? Things started to deteriorate, money started to go awry, performance dipped, we started to stretch out the waiting list, all those things that show an organisation's starting to fail. And that culminated with the Care Quality Commission going in and into Whipps Cross. So once you get put into special measures, that means a big part of it is you start to look at the senior team. So that's why I got asked to go quite quickly, because people start to move on quite quickly too. And we've got a new chief exec who actually gets matrix working. But one of the things was really that we really recognised early on was that just trying to manage everything across all the hospitals wasn't going to work. So actually what we've done is change it so that we've got hospital-based leadership teams, and we've still got the clinical academic groups, but actually what we want, they're the clinicians, multidisciplinary teams, that come together to kind of say, to focus more on the transformation and the pathway design. Because they never got time to do that, because they were always firefighting the latest emergency department crisis. So now the site leadership teams have a director of nursing, a medical director, a chief operating officer, and a managing director. And they are responsible for the day-to-day running of that hospital. And against an agreed set of standards and expectations on behalf of the trust. If you look at the work that David Dalton did on how to organise hospitals differently, I think we're kind of getting into what a chain of hospitals would look like, where you get the best of each of the skills. So we've done that, and the clinical academic groups are setting up networks where we're really saying, how do we do this even better? So what, you know, what does orthopaedic, great orthopaedic care for patients look like into the future? Where's the innovation going to be? So that's where that's kicked in September. But you can already start to see that there's a greater grip. So when we had a problem today at one of the sites, you can immediately, you've got senior people there all the time. And you know, you can kick things into action. What also is easier, one of the things that I found when I first went in there, if there was a problem on one site, it was really difficult to find one of the senior leaders to go over and sort it out. So I'd do a walkabout, or somebody would see something, and you'd kind of go, where's the director of nursing, where's the assistant director of nursing, where's the medical director, and there would be, but it could be in any of the sites. So now that isn't an issue, now they're based. They're still expected to work together. They have to do that if we're going to get that transformation. So they're working in that way. And then the other thing that we did was, with the CQC, if you've ever seen any of our reports, I mean, they're like this. And the CQC do write long reports, and you've got to get to the heart of what it is. So what we decided to do was not just respond to just the recommendations in the CQC. We said, actually, we're going to have an improvement plan, which is going to be our strategy for how we're going to get to a much better place. And the TDA and the Care Quality Commission, everything bought into that. So you can see on our website, we have an improvement plan, and it's called Safe and Compassionate. Because actually, that's at the heart of what we're trying to say. Everything that revolves around is the patient and delivering care safely and with compassion. And we're looking now to think about how to engage differently, because people weren't talked to, they weren't involved. They had ideas, but they were like, well, I've got this idea, but it'll never happen. So actually, we're looking at how do we have different conversations with our staff and with our patients to think about how do they help, or how do they deliver the improvements that we need to see. Because it's definitely my experience, for every problem we've got, A, somebody sorted it, and B, somebody will know the answer, and it's generally somebody that's working at the front line. So actually we've got to do that, which wasn't the culture before. One of the things that we're just embarking on is a programme called Listening into Action. I don't know whether any of you have used that, but I've certainly talked to two other trusts that with special measures that used it, and it's basically mobilising. How do you mobilise? And it focuses on having big conversations and real, lots of staff and patients together, and identifying some projects that you can actually deliver improvement in 90 days. So it's kind of lots of cycle, you know, it's really about we're having our big conversations at the minute. And it is really interesting just to see how people, when you get them together and start talking, they're full of ideas, and it is really exciting. So we're trying to change the language. And I think that's a really, really important message, which I think helps around how do you get people to connect in a different way. So what have I been up to? I have a uniform now. I think the thing to find out how to make change and understand what's going on is to get out there. It's quite hard with 5 hospitals, and I still keep, somebody did say to me the other day, you're who? Because it's really hard, even after 8 months, I haven't been to every ward. I've been to lots, but I haven't been everywhere yet, and I clearly haven't met the 6,500 nurses. But I've tried to meet a lot. So get out and talk, find out when they've got events on and try and go to them. So that's some of my midwives, actually, that were coming together for their supervisory meeting. But yeah, get together to find out what they're doing. So get out and spend time, find out what they're doing. I also do things like, I got a thank you card from a patient at the London, and I went up to, this is really interesting, I went up to the ward and I went to the office and introduced myself to the sister, who looked a little aghast. I said, I've had a letter from a patient. She went, oh God, what have I done? And I said, well, actually, what you've done is great care, and I've come to say well done and congratulations, and you should be proud. And she went, really? And actually, now I'm going to meet the patient. So some of that kind of small stuff does have a big impact, and you know, it makes people feel that you're valuing them. I think so. Get out and see what's going on. I go and talk. We've got quite a preceptorship program, really great BME leadership development program going on at the meet. So I'm trying to get out and just find out. And it's not like the role visit. I just want to know what people are feeling and what they're saying, and what the issues are, and what they think are the answer, ways to put things right. I go out and talk to patients, and I care for patients, not as often as I'd like. We have clinical Fridays like a lot of organisations, and I would say one in a week, probably every other week, I get out and go and spend some time in some clinical areas and do some care. Patients seem to think it's okay at the moment. Also, some of my patient groups, that they're from the patient-led assessment and care of the environment, cleanliness and the environment, lots of our place people. But we've got we've got some really, really great patient support who are really, really keen to help us improve. So that was, we were doing a celebration day, we were having a tea party in the Great Hall at St Bartholomew's, which was really cool. Get out and talk to patients and find out what's going on and see where we can improve. I think the other thing was that there was quite a lot of, you know, nurses that really didn't get together, and we, in terms of having common purpose. So, you know, you can say glibly, we're here to deliver good care, we're here to lead, but what's that really mean? And in these challenging times, which is, you know, with when there's so much to do, how do you get your nurse leaders together to actually talk to them about what really is important and where they need to focus effort? Because when there's so much to do, what you often find, and I did find, was that people, it's like rabbits in the headlight. It's almost like you don't know where to start. So you run around, as opposed to just taking that step back. And one of the things that I've helped and supported with my nurse leaders is about giving them time to sit back and go, what's the problems we're really trying to solve? What's really going on here? And what, therefore, do we need to do as leaders to make the change that will make the biggest impact on patient care and staff morale? And that's some of my, clearly having not a bad day. And so it's really something about small things make a big difference. When I was organising it, they said, are you going to provide lunch for them? I'm like, yeah. And they went, oh, well, you did it last time. Don't go out and buy their own sandwiches. So, you know, small things make a big difference. And, you know, we made it interactive, bit of fun, had prizes. But actually it had a serious tone, which was about, that was setting our strategic direction for the next 12 months. So we were clear about what were the things that we were really going to focus effort on to make the biggest difference. And I think one of the things that is really important to do, there was something like, I can't remember, I'm going to say 153 recommendations or expectations in the CQC report. I mean, there was tons and tons of things you must do. With warning notices, compliance actions, everything. But actually what I tried to do with, not just with the nurses, but with teams that I've been working with, is to try and simplify it. Because actually what we love in the NHS is complexity. And I kind of like that. Because I think actually it's quite hard to get to the nub of what's wrong and what you really need to fix. So I'm like a dog with a bone in that when we're talking about a problem, it's not, people want to rush into action where I'm going, no, stop, what's the problem we're really trying to solve here? So we've had never events. They're awful. Other hospitals, you know, we're not the only trust that's had never events, but actually people want to rush in and send out emails, do all sorts of things where I'm like, I did a session last week where I'm like going, no, come on, what's really going on here? Why is it that this has happened? And what do we have to fix to sustain change? So for me, there's something about simplify. And it's not, and it turns out if you really drill down to all the things that aren't working well when we're looking at care delivery and staff morale, it boils down to really those four themes, which is about making sure you've got the right numbers of staff. First of all, what is it? How do you make sure, using the tools that we've got? And I know there's loads of politics around that at the minute, but actually, as professionals, we need to be setting our staffing levels, using evidence-based practice, using the range of tools and professional judgment to actually say, this is what we need. That was a really, really important first step, and it was the first thing that I did. The second bit was that this, actually, if you've got a lot of nurses, or any clinicians, that have been working in an organisation for 20 plus years, and you haven't been investing in their development, then actually I think people forget things. So unless you can be absolutely assured of the knowledge, skills and competence, then you have to put systems in place, and you have to have a way to make sure that you can rapidly skill people when there are problems. But also, for the future, if you get a bunch of people in, you want to make sure that they know all the things that you think they should know. It reminded me of when I did the Healthcare Associated Infection Programme. I did used to stand on stage and say, nurses and doctors know how to do aseptic technique. Wrong. Because actually they hadn't been trained in the good old fashioned ways with a brown book and an assessment. So you have to make sure that you've got the tools, the mechanisms, and so that was that's one of the second big tasks. And then there's the whole bit about leadership and what you really mean by that and what's the way that you want to lead, because there's so much literature on leadership, and you know, there's something about what does the literature tell you about where you want to go and what approaches you need to take to try and get the outcomes that you're seeking. So talk a little bit about that in a moment. And then the last bit is this notion of how well are people doing? And actually I have no metrics, I have no more dashboard. I couldn't tell you where my worry boards were without going and asking people, because I couldn't click up and say, where are my pressure ulcer problems? But we had no agreed metrics other than the normal ones that are captured, but they're all in different systems. So measurement is really, really important on this journey, because you know it's almost like if you don't know where if you don't know what you want and you don't know where you're going, you probably end up in the wrong place. So actually having measures and being really clear about trajectories, about where you want to go, was really, really important. And actually, if you get the right numbers of staff with the right skills, and I put compassion, and you've got great leaders that empower and kind of get the pride in it's my ward and what you're doing here, and you measure the impact of what's going on, actually that's at the heart of whether you're improving pressure ulcers, falls, anything. So we put a lot of effort. Now, that sounds like four things, but I'll tell you it's rather a lot of actions, I promise you. But every problem that I've come up against, it's whether it's the never events or awards that I've gone to where I'm worried about the care, it hinges on that. And so there's something for me about leading. You have to put these basics in as well, because it doesn't matter how empowering you are if you haven't got the right numbers of staff or they haven't got the right skills and you have no idea whether they're making progress. So it really sits at the heart for me of what we have to do. I think the also thing is the setting expectation. We haven't got, the culture isn't one of absolute safety. We're not a Salford. I wish we were one day. But you know, Salford, you absolutely lives and breathes, but they've been working at creating a safety culture for 10 years. So it doesn't feel yet that people have kind of got their heads into avoiding harm. So for me, this is something I say to a lot of my staff wherever I go, because I think that sits at the heart of it. If you don't stop somebody, are, if you see something happening, you don't act. I also think that Yara's culpable. But, you know, that's the, that, it's simple in terms of having simple messages about what expectation you have. So what did I observe? I go back to what happens to people when you're in an organisation where there's been a lot of change, they've not felt empowered, they've not been developed. And I think what happens and what I've seen is people normalise stuff. And what I mean by that is, you know, wards that have more, that keep getting pressure ulcers, it becomes the norm. That's how we used to view infection. People went, infection happens in 2004. It's an inevitable consequence of complex care. So it was normalised, where in reality, what we had to do was change that. So that kind of normalisation is really, really important to get people to kind of, I call it the oh my God moment, you know, which is, whoa, what's happening here? And it's not a criticism of anyone, it's just how it is. And I think it's how it is in a number of challenged organisations. I think there's also something that I was really taken with the work that Yvonne Sawbridge and Alistair Houston's done from Birmingham University, that they've called it the emotional labour. Have you read their stuff? Have you seen the TEDx that Yvonne Sawbridge has done? If you haven't, just watch it. It's so powerful. It's only 15 minutes. You can get it on YouTube or on the TEDx app. But the literature on what happens to people when they're in the same area doing the same things, and it obviously came out of the back of Francis and saying, why do people deliver bad care? And I'm really taken with this because I think it's a part of what I've seen in some of my areas, not just at Barts, but when I've gone out and about else to other trusts. It's quite startling that Menzies actually said, actually nurses particularly, she describes the tasks that nurses do as often disgusting and distasteful and quite frightening. And it stores up the emotion. And it basically says that over time, if you don't get support, that actually means that you start to withdraw. And that's where you start to see people not lifting their head up when you go onto a ward to welcome you. And the work becomes more task focused. And I've definitely seen that. I've been on a ward, I spent a morning on a ward that I was a little bit worried about, or quite worried about, that the care was not poor care, but it was task orientated care. Patients weren't being neglected. They just could have had so much more. And I think it was this, I think the staff on that ward, over time, the emotional stuff had taken its toll. So actually understanding that and wondering if that's one of the reasons why you might have troubled areas is really worth looking at. I think also, you know, there's also the issue of whether you've got right nurses with the right skills that you can't rule out. I think that's an important thing, and thinking about strategies for how we support nurses and some of the stuff I'm going to look at now, which is how can we use the literature on emotional labour to think about how we might support people in a different way to see whether we can get that reconnection. Now I know their work that they've done when they've done restorative supervision type models has been really revealing that people have done something, you know, have reconnected. But I think that's important because that's certainly worth thinking about. The other thing that stared me in the face is people don't assure. And that's not a trait just for Barts Health, that's why I've spent so much time out and helping trusts. What we do is we reassure. So when there's a problem, the first thing you say is get out to the ward and have a look what's going on. So you send somebody out to go to the ward and they go to talk to the staff and they say, what have you been doing, blah blah blah, and they'll tell them a story. It's like, well, don't worry, I've done this, done that. So they start the reassurance, then that person comes back like, I've been to the ward, we've had a good chat, and they're going to do it. That's reassurance. And the other thing that we do is we assume people. So back to the stuff about competence, we assume that nurses, I'll take the never event example, and we assume that nurses still know how to put in a nasal gastric tube and make sure that they always check the aspirate before they start feeding. We assume that's the case. And then what you find is that you get a never event and then you start delving. So assuming is pretty risky. Reassuring people will just lull you into a false sense of security. And what you really need to do is that bit of how do you absolutely know that the care that you're delivering or the care or the outcomes that you're seeking are being done consistently? What's the range of processes? I could do a whole lecture on that, but I would say it's really around, are your staff trained? Have you got the right controls in place? How do you check? And how do you check properly? What's the feedback from patients and what staff saying? So you kind of look to do it in a range of ways. We tend to just do one bit unless we're doing it really, really well. And I think that's a really important bit, because whatever you're trying to do to change, thinking about how you assure and what good practice looks like around that is really, really important. I've got to change that actually, because it should say, has the army from the CQC gone? 62, we have. I can't think, they're coming back to do the whole trust next year. Can you imagine how many are going to have to come? They'll probably have to hire out the hotel down the road. So people are nervous. So there's a lot of fear to act because people are worried about consequences. And one of the leadership challenges about giving people permission to do things. So that's definitely there. We're still there in lots of places. So what does the literature tell us about approaches that you can take to lead people through change? I was quite taken with this simple six approach to what the characteristics are to get a healthy culture, because I think that's what I'm trying to get. I think that's what we're trying to get. We're trying to get the culture to be healthy, and actually that the culture is about safe care, compassionate care, and it's too mixed at the moment. So I think that's quite good. I think there's something about what is the compelling vision. I won't take you through all that, you can read it for yourself, but that's not a bad framework that you could use. I like Marshall Gunn's definition, because it certainly applies to Bart's Health, and I suspect quite a lot of other organisations that are challenged. Marshall Gunn actually says that leadership isn't nearly as important when everything's going well, but actually it's incredibly important at times when people face uncertainty. And you know, you could put that in any hospital, any trust in the country, because I think the challenges, the financial challenges, the lack of nursing, lack of medics, I think we're in really, really turbulent times at the moment. And you know, that uncertainty needs really, really good leadership. I think it's just something that was really, I liked this one, because I think this is what we're trying to do, that because of this kind of normalised behaviour, we do want people to wake up out of the inertia. And I like Professor Cantor's definition of that. Because what we're trying to do is excite people again, get them thinking about why we all come to work and what we're really here to do. So I liked that, I thought that was good. I thought this was interesting. I only found this this week when I was prepping for, which was really Sean Murphy's Habits of Motivational Leaders. And actually what it was really saying to me was that actually you've got to have different leadership styles, but actually, which makes sense, but you've got to flex it to the people that you're working with at the time. But also that kind of motivational leadership is about building strong networks. I'm talking to my chief exec today about networks, bringing like-minded people together to talk about the things that matter, and giving them space to do that is a really good motivator, I think. So some of those I thought was quite good. part of what we've got to do in the challenge is to try to gee people up in simple language, really, which is to build self-esteem. I've definitely got on a lot of nurses with low self-esteem. I went to the leadership programme for our BME leaders, and you know, they've had some of the stories they were telling me about, really, I would say, the lack of opportunity that they've been given, you know, was quite heart-wrenching, really. And that wasn't just their experience at Bart's Health. You know, and thinking, so for me, I was talking about ways that to help them think about how great they were and what they were really good at and where they needed to go. But it was about trying to boost personal esteem, because I think that's really sits at the heart of how you can really start to drive improvement. I think also on your journey, I found some amazing people, some awesome people who are like sitting there, that, you know, doing their job, doing just fantastic, innovative, creative things that are just there. So trying to promote some of those. I found one of the ward staff, one of the ward leaders on the ward, where most of the patients are immunosuppressed and they're all in single rooms and they don't, you know, they're there for a long time because of their illnesses. And, you know, he just did something really, really simple, like he set it up in a way that they could come out for breakfast. You know, they were obviously sitting apart, but, you know, just trying to think creatively about how to look after his patients differently. And he just kind of did that and, you know, told them, we got him to come to the board and tell his story about what he'd done to improve patient care. So for me, there's some stars, and you've got to bring them out of their shell and use them. And I think just lots of praise for all the good things goes a long way. So I think one of the things that I'm saying to you is that to get people into a different frame of mind and think about how to lead, you actually have to connect with people on a different level. What we often talk about we give instructions, we tell, and we base, you know, the evidence base for this is X, so that's what we have to do. And actually, part of making change happen is getting people to connect on a different level. So I think as a nurse, the way that I'll make the biggest impact is to get my nurses to connect on a professional level about why they came to do what they did and what they need to do differently to reconnect, to get that heart back, you know, to get the heart back into why they came into being a nurse in the first place. So actually looking at the emotional, the spiritual and the physical is a really, really good way to think about how am I tackling the conversations that I'm having. Am I having a logical argument, or actually am I trying to get to the heart and connect in that way? And obviously that was the source that from Radcliffe has developed that framework. I think what's important to also be as a leader is actually to understand the evidence of how you get change at large scale. So it's not enough to just read a bit about the literature of large scale change. I think as leaders, we have to understand it. And if we don't understand it deeply, we have to go and study it to really get a real sense of how we have to lead differently. So I did an online program with Harvard on mobilizing and organizing for leadership. And actually it was with Marshall Gans, because I wanted to know what the latest literature was and the latest thinking on how do you get people to connect when you really, it was before I went to Bart's, but it's helped given there's so many people there. How do you lead differently? And your actions may be quite different from what you thought they would be, because you're actually connecting at a different level. So actually, there's a whole load of work being done to look at change at scale. And so I would say to you that if you're not familiar with it and you're in a leadership role, it's really, really worth getting a bit more info on it. I think the other thing, that even if you're winning hearts and minds, as I go back to my four things, you have to win hearts and minds, but actually you have to be organised. And Marshall Gans talks about mobilising and organising for large scale change. So the mobilising is the winning the hearts and minds, but actually the organising means you have to have the plans. You have to, you know, you need a plan of how you're going to get from A to B. and it has to be detailed, and it has to have timelines, it has to have measures in, and you have to follow it. So I thought, you know, you have to do this with focus, pace and grip at the same time as creating a compelling story. So what do you need to do that on a personal level? And what is it, what is it meant I've thought about in the 8 months that I've been on secondment at St Bart's Health? So I think actually you need to have emotional intelligence, and I think everybody in a leadership position needs a coach that gives you a chance to think about you and what you're about, and how you can be the best that you can be. That's Daniel Goleman's work on emotional intelligence. I think is really, it's pretty straightforward, but it says what the features are of an emotionally intelligent person are. I'll say that I'm still a work in progress, but I can at least understand where I should be going. And the practice being calm is definitely work in progress. So some of those things, I think it's really, really important, I think, to thrive in a really, really challenging time, to build your emotional intelligence. And what the literature says is, you know, you may not be emotionally intelligent, but you can develop your emotional intelligence. So it's not like you're a lost cause if you're not very emotionally intelligent. There's hope for us all. You have to be incredibly resilient. And the resilience is something that I didn't realise how tough it would be. And I think I'm quite resilient. You know, I did the 6 years of the MRSA when the numbers weren't going down, and everybody kept telling, you know, saying it was going to fail. And that was really, really hard. But actually on a day-to-day basis, when you've got patients in A&E, when you're so busy, the level of resilience that you've got to have is huge, and the toll of the constant pressure that we work under in acute settings particularly, enormous. And so again, understanding what resilient factors are and where do you need to do work with either a coach or just kind of think about. I think the one thing I've learned about being a resilient person about myself is that bit about you've got to be optimistic. You know, even though it's really, really tough, you've got to believe you get there. I absolutely know that Bart's Health can turn around what it's doing. If it gets good systems, processes and fix it and delivers that plan, it will get out of special measures and will improve. I have no doubt about that. But then, you know, I'm definitely a glass half full girl. So, but some of that's really, really important. I think the other bit about, I think the second one down about avoid making a drama out of a crisis. When you're when you're challenged, you do want to rush off and do things, as opposed to just taking a deep breath and just going, let's just think about this, let's, before we rush in headlong. I think that happens. And I think the other bit is when you start to see, the jargon is green shoots of improvement, but when you start to see things getting better, then you've got to celebrate it. And we've been doing some work on trying to get all our e-rostering improved so that we're 8 weeks ahead with all the e-rostering. And it's, you know, our compliance to do that was 20%, and it's gone up to 35% today. So I sent the chief exec an email going, green shoots. I was really pleased because that's a lot of effort that have gone into that. But, you know, we've still got a long way to go, but you celebrate. I think that's the other thing about that I've learned. So actually, the days are tough, but every day, even though it has been, I'll say, the toughest job I've done, there's always some joy in each day because I've asked some amazing people and you see some fantastic things. So I think that's quite useful. I think you have to get really good at that, because you definitely are spinning loads and loads of plates. And I've developed a habit that I never had. It was always Tony that's done that, which was keeping lists. So, I have a plastic wall, you know, magic papers, and, you know, every week I start the week with my list. which it's a real, I'm so proud of the discipline I've developed for it, but actually there's so many things that you've got to think about that unless you've got a list or you have a little plan, you can struggle. So there is lots of plate spinning going on. I think the challenges that are outside our control, and I would say in any organisation, is an organisation gets into trouble, but the scale of St Bart's and Bart's Health is huge. So when people are expecting improvement in weeks, and it doesn't happen, it's unrealistic. And but actually if you don't make improvement at a reasonable pace, people will lose confidence in you, and patients will lose confidence in you. So for me, there's something about it's a challenge. I think the other thing that I just want to share this with you, which is, I called it the commitment compliance model. If you're not performing at anything, you have to demonstrate that you're compliant. But actually, if you look at the literature on large-scale change, actually what you've got to gain is commitment. You've got to get people to commit to change, and you should ultimately stop talking about compliance. But actually, when everybody wants their compliance information, but equally, until you have a degree of confidence, you've got to have some data and information, and you've got to know that people are doing the things, because for such a long time they haven't been. So I think it is a real challenge that you have to use the language, you have to get people to submit information, but you have to do it like the community to do it. And you've got to change the language with your staff around that. But that's some of the work on large scale change, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. I think the real tough bit about being in special measures, and I say any organisation that might not even be in special measures might have requires improvement, is the scrutiny that you're under. And I think that's quite relentless. And I added up one week, I spent 15 hours sitting in meetings being scrutinised. And I just listed some of these. All these people want to know what we're up to. Now, we've tried to organise it, so we put them all in a room once a month. But it is like standing room only. And people sit down. But equally, there's, you know, the joint overview and scrutiny, the health watch. They want to know what you're doing. And in a way, I don't blame them, because if you're in a bad place, until you can show them that you're getting in a better place, then they're going to keep asking. So you can't underestimate the toll that takes, and actually the resources that you have to put into it. You know, we have people employed that are just providing all that information for all the time, but literally all those people are interested in some, you know, in Bart's house at the moment. So that's kind of the journey. So I'm 8 months in, I am on secondment and I'm not going to stay there permanently. What am I proud of? What have I done that I think is helping Bart's Health get back on its journey? I think that I've started to tackle some of the variations in care. Like most organisations, there's some stunning, outstanding care and there's some pretty mediocre care. And what we've done is seek that out by using data information, lots of walkabout, and starting to look at making changes, well, we've made some changes, where care isn't of the standard that you would want to expect. And so I'm proud of that. All my leaders from about 6, 7, 8, I call them the 8 pluses, have all got competencies and a development programme, and we're working through that with them at the minute. You can now click on my computer, on a computer, and each ward has a dashboard. It's not completed yet, but we've got the metrics that we want to look at that we know will demonstrate whether we're being compassionate, safe, delivering good care, which includes views from patients and et cetera. That is now live. We're turning it into an accreditation programme because I want to put some pride and competition. So if you look at the work Salford's done on their accreditation and others on accreditation, I think showing, you know, people that get to green or gold, whichever colour is being used, I'm hugely, hugely proud of that, and I want to put some of that in. Every nurse, we're about to launch, every nurse will have their own revalidation tool. We've purchased it, and we'll be able to access education materials that will enable them to more easily revalidate. And you know, we're not expecting nurses to go and do that themselves. So as part of our revalidation programme of work, we're doing that. Eyelid complaints, and at one point, the worst case, there was 140 complaints unanswered for over 25 days. It's gone down to about 40 now. We've actually also, by tackling some of the quality issues, reduced the number of complaints. I said the number's large. We normally 350 complaints a month, down to two, just out in the 200 range. So that's, I'm quite proud of that. And they're really committed to that, and they're really committed to doing all we can to recruit nurses. We've done really well with our midwives. We've recruited nearly all our midwives now, so we've not got lots of vacancies in midwifery. We put back sisters in charge as part of that, and that's, I think that is fundamental to trying to get the pride and the control back on the wards. A lot of them haven't been used to running a ward, even though they were band seven, so actually a lot of their development is going on around that. And as part of the money, the 20 million they got put in, we got more time for training so that actually we can keep our staff, because we know that the main reason people come to Barts Health is because they want training, and actually the main reason that they leave is because they didn't get it. So we recruited 1,100 nurses last year, and 700 left. I know, I've done a lot. So actually, by putting that better investment in, and actually we've had a preceptorship programme running, because obviously you know from the literature that we lose a lot of nurses in the first year, and we recruited over 100 from the Abtegi University a year ago, and we've only lost two in a year, so I'm quite proud of that. And also we've recruited, we've worked with the universities, and all our student nurses get given a contract to be a healthcare assistant on the bank, and that meant we recruited 94% of them this year. So we had 100 started last month, and 100. Some of the nursing has now gone down to 800, as long as we've not lost too many from other bits. So I'm proud of that, really. And what I'm really proud of is nursing's definitely got a stronger voice than it had 8 months ago. And it's not just my voice. What people are doing is blossoming and getting their pointy elbows back, which I think is really important. So I would say that I'm proud of all that, and I know I played a part in it, maybe by kind of setting the tone, but I couldn't have done it without the way my staff have risen to the challenge, and have actually, my bit is to give them confidence and let them fly, and that's what they've done, I think, although we're still on a journey. And you've got to keep, you know, people want results yesterday, and you can stick in plaster it, or you can do it properly. And the last thing I learned is I've forgotten how much I loved being a nurse in a uniform and out there and leading nursing. So that's it. So I think thank you very much.